Happy Sabbath. Welcome. Oh, it is working. I trust everybody had a week. So, let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we praise you for another week that you have seen us through, Lord. As we watch this earth crumbling before our eyes and evil appears to be ruling the day, help us, Lord, to make the choice to stand for you and to be refined in the fire, Father, that we may do your will and do that which pleases you always. Be with us this Sabbath day. Help us to accomplish our tasks and to have rest from the world. We praise you and ask your blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's go back, as it were, to Colossians as we look at what we have been talking about as far as Revelation 3 goes, strengthening that which remains. And how it affects us each individually. We had looked at what Paul says about Colossians 3, 1, 2, and 3, especially verse 2, set your affections on things above, not on things of the earth. For you are dead, and your life is hid with Christ in God. Total opposite of every message that is out there. Is it not? Do I exaggerate? Whether it's a religious message or a secular message, that is totally, completely opposite. We are not dead. We are teaching our young people, have been for decades, that self-esteem. How does that fit with that? Prior to Saul becoming Paul, he was full of self-esteem, wasn't he? A Pharisee amongst Pharisees, as it were. What do you call that? But anyhow, I want to move on from that. And if we are dead and Christ lives, then what does that mean? In a nutshell. What did Jesus say? Oh, Bill took off with the mic. Oh, Rita has it. Okay. If we are dead in Jesus, dead in Christ, and he lives, what does that mean? What is our purpose? To live for Jesus, and what did Jesus live for? He always did that which what? Which pleased his father. The microphone seems to be an issue this morning. kind of a hot potato. Hilda wants you to say something, I guess, Cody.
Well, okay, I'll say something, Hilda. at the end of Matthew, when they get the Great Commission, that's our job. And that's really what I see, especially in my school. Mine's it's a multi-denominational, you know, little melting pot there. And everybody is all about self-improvement and all these, which is, you know, a part of it, I guess. You know, but they're focusing on different things. But none of us are focusing on our goal to reach others or doing missions or anything like that or just reaching others in general in everyday life. It's all about the next study or the next social group activity that you're going to do as a church. That's what it's all about, social clubs.
Yep. Rita. Well, the thing, too, though, with the self-improvement thing, there's no such thing. That's an illusion.
No, it's not an illusion. It just brought to mind, we are supposed to self-improve every day, but not according to the world, but according to Christ, because that is our sanctification.
See, according to what Paul says here, for you are dead and your life is hid in Christ. How can you possibly improve yourself if you don't believe that statement? That's right. We are supposed to, but through the strength of what? Our own? The arm of flesh? Or through the Holy Spirit?
And what are we supposed to use as a goal? Ah. It's supposed to be Christ-likeness, not like the world.
Well, and what is the standard? Jesus. Is it that the law is done away with? How can you possibly improve yourself if you believe that? Then by whose... What standard are you? Yeah, what did Jesus say to the first century church? You worship me in vain. Because for rules and regulations, you've got your own, not mine. See, we don't like that word. Those words, rules, regulations, law, it's all been superseded by one word. What is that? Love, so-called. Well, God's not going to do this, and we're not going to... God's going to not accept me. He loves me. Yeah, he does. That's part of the reason why those who do not come up to the standard will be destroyed. Because those whom love him back have the right then, because of what Jesus did, to live in a society that will never, ever, ever go through this again. So out of love, those who do not choose to live according to God's law will be destroyed. Because this will never happen again. Simple. So that is an act of love, isn't it? It's a great sacrifice on their part because they will carry sorrow for even Lucifer himself after this is over. Rita and then Kody.
And this is not what God wants to do. He No. wants everybody to be saved. That's why we're still here, because he's long-suffering and forbearing. He wants everybody to take advantage of what he did through his son. But that's why it's called his strange act, because this is not what he wants to do.
Nope.
I was talking with another person, a sister in Christ, and she's comes from a different denomination, and we were talking about achieving perfection in this life. And how it is possible to do that. And she said that, no, it's not possible, you know. And that's because that's what's been taught in teaching. And like the nail or the law has been nailed to the cross, you know. And it's just, if sin will never rise up a second time, then, and if we've done away with the law, then, and sin is the transgression of the law, then how will sin not rise up a second time if we don't even know what it is, what sin is anymore? So it just makes no sense.
Paul's very clear on that fact. Without the law, there is no sin. If it had not been for the law, I would not know sin. I mean, it's absurd to even say that. But anyhow, Mrs. White says here, when self is hid in Jesus, we are shielded from the fiery darts of the enemy. I want to go to early writings, page 72. The very time to exercise faith is when we feel destitute of the Spirit. When thick clouds of darkness seem to hover over the mind, then it is time to let living faith pierce the darkness and scatter the clouds. True faith rests on the promises contained in the Word of God, and those only who obey that Word can claim its glorious promises. If you abide in me, and my word abides in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. John 15:7. Whatsoever we ask, we receive of him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing to him in his sight. How can you say the law? What commandments? What is John talking about if you believe the law is done away with and you're saved in sin? How does that verse work there? And it's connected to the very act of faith. Isn't that interesting? So it's connected to the shield of faith, which that's what we ended up with last week. We determine how thick our armor is. Not God. He gives it to us. And by the way, where is the shield of faith? What part of the armor is the shield of faith? We think of it as, Well, yeah, but no. The fiery darts of the devil, where are they aimed at? The mind. What does it say right here? So there's your shield of faith. It's not some thing you're holding in your hand as we picture knights in battle and when this was written. There's your shield of faith. If the holiness to the Lord, as we just read here, and this is where Mrs. White expounds upon the Bible, it only stands to logic that the devil seeks to penetrate the mind with his thoughts. What need be shielded, the body or the mind? So there's your shield of faith, holiness to the Lord. Which, by the way, that little piece of gold right there corresponds directly to the mercy seat. Did you know that? Why do I say that? Because it's a solid piece of gold. There's only one other place. The mercy seat is a solid piece of gold. You understand? Holiness to the Lord. What makes holiness to the Lord? Keeping, doing that which always pleases him is doing what? Keeping his commandments. John just said it. I didn't say it. And as this woman, unfortunately, related to God, we hear it. I hear it from Seventh-day Adventists. I don't have as much interaction with other on that level. But I hear it from Seventh-day Adventists. Oh, you can never be perfect. That's not going to happen. I hear that from within my own family. Really? Then what do we do with this piece of the helmet? What do we do with it? What do we do with it? I mean, if you want to believe, then, you know, and that's an option. I'm not going to get in an argument over there that it's a physical shield that goes head to body, head to foot. That's fine. However, let me read on. We should be much in secret prayer. Christ is the vine. We are the branches. And if we would grow and flourish, we must continually draw up sap and nourishment from the living vine. For separated from the vine, we have no strength. I asked the angel why there was not much more faith and power in Israel. He said, you let go of the arm of the Lord too soon. Press your petitions to the throne and hold on by strong faith. Now, again, this is another hint in my mind. Yes, there's a shield. However, we can't press our petitions and hold on with faith with that shield. We do that with this. Isn't that correct? And, you know, I find it interesting. Whenever you watch these sword fight movies and these old movies years out, what is the first thing that these knights always lose? Do you ever notice? No, well, that's today. They always lose their shield. Especially when they're fighting a fire-breathing dragon, which is the only thing that keeps the fight. They always lose their shield immediately, you see, and then they're vulnerable. You ever notice that? And then the sword gets knocked. But the point is, that shield you can never lose. Once it's put on your head, you make the choice. The devil cannot take that shield from you in battle if we constantly press our petitions before the throne of it. If we do that which constantly pleases God, that shield can't come off. Can't lose that shield. You can't lay that shield down and walk away from it. It's either there or it's not. And who determines whether it's there? We do. She says, the promises are sure. Believe that you receive the things you ask for and you shall have them. I was then pointed to Elijah. He was subject to like passions as we are, and he prayed earnestly. His faith endured the trial. 7 times he prayed before the Lord, and at the last the cloud was seen. I saw that we had doubted the sure promises and wounded the Savior by the lack of faith. There's another hint as to the fact that that's not just a defensive weapon, the shield. Because what would Elijah need a shield of faith for to make it rain? The fiery dart the devil was shooting, to see the Lord in the cloud. The fiery dart he was shooting is that the Lord's not going to answer your prayer. Isn't that it? And where was that going to take its toll? Right there. So a handheld shield was of no value to him at that point. It was the battle, the great controversy was going on right here. And he had to believe. no matter what. And he had just been through an ordeal, hadn't he? He had wavered a little, hadn't he? Said the angel, gird the armor about you, and above all, take the shield of faith. For that will guard the heart, the very life, from the fiery darts of the wicked. Now, what heart is being referred to here? Jesus himself said, don't worry about he who can kill the body. What did he say? That can kill, put you in the lake of fire, is what he said. That's that shield right there. The other one protects the body, isn't it? Doesn't it? Did David have that kind of a shield when he walked against Goliath? Did he have the shield that we always think this means? What shield did he have? Total and complete faith that the Lord would deliver him from how many tens, 20, scores of thousands of Philistines? No, Saul's shield couldn't have done a thing for him other than get him killed. So he had that, he was wearing that shield right there. And there was no way that the devil or Goliath and his brothers could ever penetrate that shield. And you know the amazing thing, when you go back to that story, David didn't waver for a second. Do you know the biggest thing I think that would have caused David to have second thoughts wasn't so much his enemy. Because you know the interesting thing, his enemy in front of him. The interesting thing is with a soldier and in battle, when a soldier discerns that they're going to die for that cause, usually a peace comes over them. It's a decision that has been made that they are going to do what they said they were going to do. I think the bigger thing was all the mockery and all the problems he was getting from his own people. Isn't that usually the bigger problem? Interesting. That could undermine that shield of faith more so than the enemy that was in front of him, because he knows what to expect from Goliath. But the accusations and the lies and the things that were said about him by his own family and his own countrymen, because he was standing up for the honor of God, that's where he needed that thick shield of faith. Do you agree with that, or you think? Because he had already determined he was going to go fight Goliath. And he wasn't afraid of Goliath because he says, I fought bear, I fought lions. You know.
Kind of goes back, Paul, to the statement Ellen White made when she said, we have nothing to fear for the future except we forget the way the Lord has led us in the past.
Amen.
And his teachings in our past history. So if we remember what God has done and the ways he has opened up doors and opportunities and given us victories, there's nothing to fear for what's ahead.
That's the whole point. I mean, look at what was going on with Israel when Moses and Aaron went back to Egypt to get them out. From the moment they left, right up to the point of entering into the land that the Lord meant to give them, doubting, forgetting what had happened, accusations, turmoil within the camp. They ended up being rejected for 40 years. Great hardships and penalties came upon them for it. Rebellion within the camp, all of it. But they, you know, you think, well, how could they forget? I mean, forget the parting of the Red Sea. What about the plagues that didn't affect them, that totally brought the world power to its knees? What about that? I don't know. But we're worse than they are because we're Laodiceans. We have all these evidences. If the enemy can lead the desponding to take their eyes off from Jesus and look to themselves, now this is tricky. Tricky because, oh, I've got to make self-improvement. Watch this transition. And dwell upon their own unworthinesses instead of dwelling upon the worthiness of Jesus, his love, his merits, his great mercy. He will get away their shield of faith and gain his object. It is not something you're holding here to protect you. It's right here. So this idea of I've got to make myself better without seeking to uphold God's law only leads to that. Or it goes the other way, to pride. Like the Pharisees. Oh, yeah, this dirty, filthy publican praying. He has no right here. Look at me. He's totally wicked, that man. He's totally sold himself out to the devil to make those statements. Kody?
And even there is no real self-improvement without Jesus. That is an act of faith. Keeping the commandments is an act of faith as well. Yeah. And I wanted to read something from 1 John 5. It says, by this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. And for this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. For whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. So it's our faith that is the key to everything.
That's a fact. And that's a psychological and mental issue. So strengthen the things that remain. When we look at it in this light, people come and go, and I had read before, because of selfish motivations. And I have my rights, and I have this, and I have that. No, you have nothing. You have death. Either we do it God's way, or there is no other way. Let me finish reading this. It says, now, his love, his great mercy. He will get away their shield of faith and gain his object. They will be exposed to the fiery temptations. The weak should therefore look to Jesus and believe in him. They then exercise faith. This shield is nothing we're holding like this. Now, it's interesting. When Nehemiah, when they were building the wall, what did Nehemiah tell them to get when they were coming under attack? Did he tell them to get a shield? What did he tell them to get? A sword. If you're holding a shield, how are you going to work? You're hiding. You're cowering behind that. Nehemiah said, put your sword on. Well, it's the same today. We need to strap our sword to our side. What is that sword, by the way? Yeah, we're going to look at that. Go ahead, Rita.
When you're dead to self, you don't have any rights. You're dead. It doesn't matter. Mrs. White says, it is the love of self that destroys our peace. While self is all alive, we stand continually ready to guard it from mortification and insult. But when we are dead and our life is hid with Christ in God, we shall not take neglects and slights to heart. We shall be deaf to reproach and blind to scorn and insult. This is it. We're constantly trying to defend ourselves. She said that's not a noble action, to constantly trying to defend self.
No. Not at all. So we need to guard ourselves, too. And in the fact that it says here, strengthen that which remains, there's also an indication there that there's going to be a split, correct? How can you have a remnant if there wasn't a split? It stands to reason that those which are no longer there are not going to be your friends anymore. Because Jesus said that that doesn't work. Two cannot walk together unless they agree. So this whole idea that we can be saved in sin totally strips us of the armor of God and leaves us completely available to the Satan's whim, to the devil's whims. You think that's true? Of course it is. Oh, I can't be perfect. Well, there goes your shield of faith. And your mind is open to whatever the devil wants to put in there. What do you need any more armor for? Because you're going to start teaching the wrong things out of the Bible. You're going to start twisting the Bible. Those who claim to be Jews but are what? Of the synagogue of Satan. Do you see how that can happen? Of the synagogue of Satan. We need to guard ourselves. And how do we do that? With that shield of faith. Let's go back to Revelation 3. And on verse 3, I want to read some more of Mrs. White's commentary. She says here, "Hold fast to the pledge. Remember, therefore, how you have received and heard, and hold fast and repent. Those who have been born again, remember of with what joy and gladness they received the light of heaven, and how eager they were to tell everybody of their happiness. Hold fast." This does not mean hold fast to your sins, but hold fast to the comfort, the faith, and hope that God has given you in His Word. Never be discouraged. A discouraged man can do nothing. Satan is seeking to discourage you, telling you it is of no use to serve God, that it does not pay, and that it is just as well to have pleasure and enjoyment in this world. I tell you, this is not written to heathens. Who is this written to? What is she talking about? Mixing, what did Paul say? We got to leave the things of this earth behind. Mixing the church with the world. And no matter how tiny the principle is, folks, it is a major deal when we choose to do our will over counsel. You disagree with that? Mrs. White says in other places, don't worry about the big things. There's nothing at all you can do to affect the big things. It's the little tiny things every day in your life. What does that mean? It no longer becomes what the item is. It's what the issue is. Is there counsel saying I should not do this? But if I choose to do it, what am I doing? See that shield of faith? It's gone. No matter how tiny it is. Now that scene today is fanatical and judgmental. And this is how we see if we're walking with the Lord. This is what Paul is talking about looking in the mirror. It says, But what shall it profit a man if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? You may have worldly pleasure at the expense of the future life, but can you afford to pay such a price? Interesting question. And you know, when we read this, we're Americans. We're wealthy, rich people in the world standard, no matter how poor you may be here. When we see about gaining the world, what do we think as Americans? Millionaire status? Oh no, that's not what she's talking about. What is she talking about? Oh, I'm happy, I'm fine, I'm good in my own little realm. I'm doing my will, and as the song at Sinatra, I did it my way, you see. I'm serving God my way. This is talking about people in the Seventh-day Adventist church. Gaining the world does not mean that you have to have millions and millions of dollars. It means you've made a balance in your life, in your mind, between religion and secularism, and said, oh, I'm fine. I don't have to come up to the standard of the wall. You see, that pesky wall of that sanctuary, that is such a problem. The gold goes from the bottom of the floor to the top of the wall, and where do we have to keep our character? From the bottom of the floor to the very top of the wall. Not somewhere in the middle, you see. It's got to be all the way up to the top that the wood is covered with the gold. Not somewhere where I determined to draw that mark, you see. No, it's from the bottom of the floor to the top of the wall. The fragrance from the wood is coming from behind that gold, and it is not halfway up. It is not three-quarters of the way up, it is to the top of the wall. When we step into the sanctuary to be cleansed, we are covered to the top of the wall. Does that make sense? The whole thing is gold. Around the outside of the tabernacle, the white sheet was from the bottom to the top, it was white. The righteousness of Christ. Not in the middle. Didn't change color. The whole thing was white. The wedding garment is white from the floor to the neck. Not this half and half garbage. Let's go to Luke 12. Or no, I'm sorry. John 15, verses 18 down. If the world hate you, know that it hated me before it hated you. If you were of the world would love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Now, Jesus said something interesting there. I have chosen you out of the world. Is that literally accurate? I know people that stumble over that. Oh, the Bible clearly says, I've chosen you 11, and one of you, and then the 12th, one of you was a devil. Jesus said, I chose you. He literally said that. But how did he choose them? How did he choose them? Did he force them or just ask them to follow him? He simply asked them. Except one. Who was that? That was brought to him. Judas. And he called him a devil. Early on. He told them, one of you is a devil. He didn't single Judas out. They should have known. They should have known. But he said, and I have chosen you out of the world. By the way, was Judas there at this time? This was after they had the Lord's Supper, after he left. There was 11 there at this time. Does Jesus choose us the same way? See, because the predestination people love this. Does he choose us the same way that he chose John, James, Peter, Matthew, Timothy, Thomas, etc., etc.? Does he? Yes. He simply calls us. He sends his spirit. Like the still small voice. And if we accept it, then he has chosen us. Fact of the matter is, he's chosen everybody on the planet that has ever lived. Now, whether they respond or not, that's a different story. Kody?
I was just going to say, against predestination, Revelation 3:5 says, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I shall not blot his name out of the book of life.
Of course.
So if predestination, you're written there, there's no reason to blot you out. You're predestined.
Yep. Yep. But people stumble over this, Kody, because, oh, you see, he chose them, and there was nothing they could do. They had to. No. He chooses you, too. How? You have to look at the process. How did Jesus choose these people? The gospel chooses everybody.
Yeah.
Even Cain.
God desires that every person be saved.
Exactly.
And it just really, it goes back to selfishness, because both predestination and once saved, always saved takes away my responsibility to take control of my own faith and continue to follow Jesus and keep my eyes
exactly
fixed on him as if my life depended on it. Which it does.
Yes.
So when we believe these things, it completely removes our responsibility. It's almost, I mean,
yep,
it's Catholic in its its origin and
yes,
the way it.
Well, and let me ask you this. Predestination and once saved, always saved. How does that line up with you don't have to be perfect to be saved? Same thing. It's exactly the same theology. There's no difference. I'm not responsible for my salvation. It's the same thread of theology. However, Jesus said, I chose you because you responded to my call. That's the rest of that statement. And how did he end up with Judas amongst his disciples? Why was Judas chosen by the other 11? They were impressed by him. He was educated. He had influence to an extent with the political class and the religious class of Jerusalem. So they felt, oh, he'd be good. And what did he turn? Jesus said he was a devil. Interesting. The ones that Jesus chose did not fall away, but the ones that man chose for their earthly achievements and merits betrayed him and ended up committing eternal suicide. Keep that in mind as we move into the future. Keep that in mind. Judas refused to wear the armor that God gave him.
I think a lot of people struggle with, including myself, thinking themselves wise. And yes. I think Judas thought himself wise, so he thought he couldn't be wrong. And that's where it all comes down with all the issues that Seventh-day Adventists have compared to the rest of the Protestant world or the world in general. It's that, and we can't think that we got it wrong in the past at some point. Instead of just saying, okay, what is the Lord's will, and seeking we would find the Sabbath to be true as a whole nation, as a whole world. You know, but we don't want to do that because we don't want to admit that we were wrong for so many years. You know, it all comes down to personal pride.
So, yes. So
Kellogg struggled with that too.
Yep. How does that describe how does that line up with the Laodicean condition? It's exactly the Laodicean condition. Increased with wealth, need of nothing. Interesting. So all this has to be applied on a religious level. Remember the word that I said to you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. If they have kept my sayings, they will keep yours also. Now, who was doing the persecuting? Who was doing the persecuting? Who was Jesus talking about? If they have persecuted me, the Seventh-day Adventists, who were in bed with the leader, with the politicians. Isn't that interesting? And if they have kept my sayings, they will keep yours also. Well, you know what? Then our teaching should be in line with that which Christ taught. Isn't that interesting? Strengthen that which remains. But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they knew not him that sent me. That is another problem. Christ was God's messenger. We lose sight of God through Christ. The churches have made an idol out of Jesus Christ and eliminated God. Because if you say the law was done away with because of what Jesus did, what are you doing to God? Did God ever say, I will do away with my law? He says, I, the Lord your God, do not change. I will not alter that which is gone out of my mouth. So if you believe that Jesus did away with the law and God will accept you because you don't keep God's law, you have just driven a wedge between Christ, God, and the church. And totally obliterated the Holy Spirit. Of course, we see that, though, don't we, in religion? Man, you can get into some real fiery discussions about the Holy Spirit, as we all know. He doesn't exist. He's not a person. Blah, 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 blah. No. He's in charge of this place. Mrs. White says he walks amongst us, doing his will, which is directed by Jesus, which is given authority over by the Father. So if you teach that Jesus, and this is exactly what the Jews did. They were serving God by killing Jesus. Really? Isn't that what they were saying? What did Gamaliel say? He had enough of it. You may find yourself fighting against God. He got it, I think. We talked about this a little bit last week. I think he got it. I think he was feeling guilty. I think he was trying to set his friends straight. Don't you realize what we've done is what he was saying, in my mind? So if you believe that, you are creating war between Jesus and God. Who wants to do that? Who wants to do that? I will ascend to the throne of the Most High. Cody?
I was just going to say, it reminds me of Psalms 2, where it talks about the whole world gathering together in council, trying to separate God from his anointed.
By teaching the law was done away with, that's exactly what it's doing. Jesus said, I have done my Father's commandments. If you love me, you will keep my commandments as I have kept his commandments. So if you say that by going to, he's fighting with his father. He doesn't agree with him. And who would that be? Whose theology is that? Who's got the beef with the father? The devil. So separate the father from the son by saying the law was done away with. Get rid of the need for the Holy Spirit by saying, well, you could be saved in sin. What do you need the Holy Spirit for? What do you need him for? And then you become a perfect Laodicean, cemented in a mess. Yeah, Bill, Kody, Bill needs the mic. It's quite simple, but ingenious.
You know, Paul, in Desire of Ages 671, as Christ was talking in the upper room, he said sin, or Ellen White says, sin can be resisted and overcome only through the mighty agency of the third person of the Godhead. So if victory, Paul, is no longer important, if victory over sin, of obedience, is no longer important, then there's no purpose for the Holy Spirit. And ultimately, Paul, the arguments that are being made against the Holy Spirit will eventually do away with him.
Yeah. So man saving man at that point. So that's Roman Catholicism. It's ancient pagan religion. Jesus goes on to say, they didn't know who sent me, but all these things they will do unto you for my name's sake, because they did not know him that sent me. If I had not come and spoken unto them, they had not sin. But now they have sin. They have no cloak for their sins. In other words, I've taken that. I've destroyed their theology. I have shown the emptiness of their religion. I have given them an ultimatum, pretty much. That's what he did. They have no excuse anymore. But keep in mind that you're going to be treated exactly the same way I was treated for the same reasons. Great Controversy, page 46. How then can the gospel be called a message of peace? When Isaiah foretold the birth of the Messiah, he ascribed to him the title Prince of Peace. When angels announced to the shepherds that Christ was born, they sang above the plains of Bethlehem, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill towards men, Luke 2:14. There is a seeming contradiction between these prophetic declarations and the words of Christ. I am not come to send peace, but a sword, Matthew 10:34. But rightly understood, the two are in perfect harmony. The gospel is a perfect message of peace. Christianity is a system which, received and obeyed, will spread peace, harmony, and happiness throughout the earth. The religion of Christ will unite in close brotherhood all who accept its teachings. It was the mission of Jesus to reconcile man to God, and thus one to another. That's why they had no excuse anymore, because they had their caste system, their separations, all of that. But the world at last are under the control of Satan, Christ's bitterest foe. The gospel presents to them principles of life which are wholly at variance with their habits and desires, and they rise in religious rebellion against it. The hate, the purity which reveals and condemns their sins. They hate the purity that reveals and condemns their sins. And they persecute and destroy those who urge upon them its just and holy claims. Now, what class of people is being referred to here? Not the heathen. Heathen doesn't care. Not the pagan, not the Satanist. They don't care. What class of people hates this? The so-called religious. The professed. Those who claim to be of Jews but are what? Of the synagogue of Satan. It's pulling the cloak off. Jesus said they don't have an excuse anymore because I personally came and showed them what it is. So what class of people is she referring to here in the great controversy? These so-called great political leaders who claim to be great religious pillars. But when they lay down their policies and they're totally contrary to what the Bible says, do you think they like that? Or if it causes problems within their constituency, they want that eliminated. So they're going to go to the minority, not the majority, to the more powerful and rich leaders, and they're going to say, you deal with these people because we want them eliminated. That's how it works. It is in this sense, because the exalted truth brings occasion, hatred, and strife, that the gospel is called a sword. The mysterious providence which permits the religious to suffer persecution at the hand of the wicked has been a cause of great perplexity to many who are weak in faith. Some are even ready to cast away their confidence in God because he suffers the basest of men to prosper, while the best and pure are afflicted and tormented by their cruel power. How, it is asked, can one who is just and merciful and is also infinite in power tolerate such injustice and oppression? This is a question with which we have nothing to do. God has given us sufficient evidence of his love, and we are not to doubt his goodness because we cannot understand the workings of his providence. Said the Savior to his disciples, foreseeing the doubts that would press upon their souls in the days of trial and darkness, remember the word that I said to you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they will also persecute you. John 15:20. Jesus suffered for us more than any of his followers can be made to suffer through the cruelty of wicked men. Those who are called to endure torture and martyrdom are but following the steps of God's dear Son. These things have to be revealed. It's not by profession, it's by action. And this is the issue with principle, no matter how small it is. So what is the church doing? They're conforming to the world, the very thing Paul said don't do. They're not dying to self. They're their own entity now. They're determining right and wrong, who's saved, who's not saved. What is the difference between the Seventh-day Adventist church saying you can be saved in sin, or the Catholic church saying, well, you have to go to a confessional to be saved? What is the difference? Is it not exactly the same thing in principle? Are they not confessing before a priest who is giving them absolution? Of course they are. Because they're believing this priest that is saying you can be saved in sin. And what does the confessional booth say? You can be saved in sin. There's the reason why, right there. And what good would it do to prosper God's people if they turn around and lose their salvation? Unfortunately, we have to go through some hardship in order to learn our lessons. And if you don't believe that, go back to your childhood. Well, we're going to close on that. Let's have prayer. Heavenly Father, we come before you this Sabbath day, this mighty, wonderful day. Father, help us to keep it holy according to the way you see fit, not how we see fit. Let us adhere to the tiniest little bit of principle in our life and allow your Spirit to usher these things away. And to strengthen our armor, Father, that the devil has no effect on us, which will outrage him greatly. But, Father, help us to overcome through faith in your Son, through your Spirit's sword, and the grace that you give us, Lord, to continue to allow us to work, to have a perfect character that will please you. Be with us the rest of this day. Help us to get our work done, and all may be pleasing in your sight. In Jesus' name, amen.